Ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to see that I'm not like the bishop who turned up at a little English country church. And as he was mounting the steps to the pulpit, the vicar behind him, he noticed there were only two or three old ladies in the audience. So he whispered to the vicar, did the bishop, and said, "Did you tell them I was coming?" "No," he said, "but word seems to have got around." But thank you so much that you've come. And it confirms in my mind what I've experienced all around the world in the last few years, the great interest of these topics. Now, I understand we've several overflow rooms and we've people watching by live streaming. And I would like to greet you as well. Now, as you see, I'm considerably old. And I've traveled a great deal, and one of the places I've been in very frequently is Siberia in Russia. And in Russia, they have a very nice habit of allowing lecturers to sit. And of course, if you know anything about biblical tradition, that is the way people taught in the ancient world. So, with your permission, I intend to sit. Now, tonight, we have a major topic. Has science buried God? I'm going to be very provocative, ladies and gentlemen, and suggest that the answer to that question is no, but that science does a very good job of burying atheism. So as we proceed, I want to develop the argument. The idea that science and God don't mix is, of course, completely false and very easy to demonstrate its falsity. Let's go to the very top of science, the Nobel Prize for Physics. Steven Weinberg of the University of Austin won the Nobel Prize. He is an atheist. A few years after him, Bill Phillips, also an American physicist, won the Nobel Prize for Physics. He is a Christian. Now that ought to be enough to demonstrate to anybody who thinks that there cannot be an essential war between science and belief in God. Because you see, what divides those two people is not their science. They have both won the Nobel Prize. That's as high as you can go. What divides them is their worldview. Weinberg, an atheist, and Bill Phillips, a Christian. And what I want to suggest to you is, if we're ever we're going to understand what's going on in our culture, we must get rid of this idea that science and belief in God are completely incompatible. The real issue is this, that we have brilliant scientists who believe in God, and we have brilliant scientists who don't. Incidentally, if you look at the list of Nobel Prize winners between 1900 and 2000, over 65% of them are believers in God. So the real question is not, are science and God incompatible, but what way does science point? Does science point to atheism, as Richard Dawkins and Lawrence Krauss would believe? Or does science point towards God, as Bill Phillips and people like myself believe? Now, I am a pure mathematician, and therefore you will understand that I shall not be proving the existence of God tonight, at least not in the rigorous mathematical sense of that word, because rigorous proof you only get in my field of pure mathematics. You don't get it anywhere else. What you can do elsewhere, of course, is give evidence, and it can be very powerful evidence. I trusted myself to a Boeing 747 to get me to the United States. I couldn't prove to you mathematically it would get me there, but I risked my life on it. I've been married to the same girl for 48 years. I couldn't prove to you mathematically that she loves me, but I'd stake my life on it. So you get the point that even though we cannot give mathematical rigor, nevertheless, the evidence can be powerful enough in order to stake your life on it. And it's in that sense I want to ask, what are the conceivable sources of evidence in this question? Well, of course, the first one is history. And I've always been fascinated by history. But it is the fact that modern science arose in the 16th and 17th centuries in Europe in a Christian culture. Is there any connection, people have asked. Alfred North Whitehead said yes, and later Merton developed it into a thesis that there was a close connection. Perhaps the best expression of it is C.S. Lewis's. Men became scientific. Why? Because they expected law of nature. Why? Because they believed in a lawgiver. In other words, modern science, ladies and gentlemen, comes directly from the conviction that there is order in nature, because behind nature there is an ordering, intelligent mind, the mind of God. So let me put it very strongly, I'm not remotely ashamed to be a Christian and a scientist, because arguably Christianity gave me my subject. You see, people like Galileo and Kepler and Newton, and coming on up through history, Clerk Maxwell, Babbage and so on, we're all believers in God. Now, to be fair to the argument, when I put this to Richard Dawkins, he said, but there's no surprise in this. Everybody believed in God in those days. But he was making a fatal mistake, because he was only describing the Western world. China didn't have belief in God, and abstract science never developed in China. Now, the interesting thing about that is that the main work on this was done by a brilliant chemist, Joseph Needham, who was a sinologist. He wrote the definitive dictionary of science and technology in China, spoke fluent Chinese and so on. But he was a neo-Marxist. And for many years he tried to explain why abstract science didn't spring up in China on the basis of neo-Marxist principles, and he failed. And in the end he admitted that the only difference he could really see between East and West was the East lacked the unifying concept of a single creator who created the universe to run according to fixed laws. So Dawkins was simply too parochial in his evaluation. Now, to be fair to the Chinese, they developed significant technologies like printing and fireworks and all this kind of thing, but not abstract science. Abstract science arose solely within a Christian culture, and the connection is totally obvious. These early pioneers believed that science could and should be done because, as one of the most famous put it, it was thinking God's thoughts after him. It was part of their admiration of God to study the way in which the universe worked. Now, this is very odd, ladies and gentlemen. Odd for the following reason. Isaac Newton believed in God. He was arguably the cleverest scientist there's ever been. The most famous living scientist is Stephen Hawking, who was a little ahead of me at Cambridge and light years ahead of me in his brain power. Stephen Hawking works on gravity. Isaac Newton discovered the law of gravity. Now, here's the interesting question that focuses the whole debate. Isaac Newton argued, in part, that the law of gravity was evidence that there was a God. Stephen Hawking argues that the law of gravity is evidence that there's no God. So what we've got is a shift in understanding from the time of Newton to Hawking, and the same scientific discovery is being used in two opposite directions. I find that fascinating. And what I want to do is to help negotiate and navigate the dialogue by simply concentrating on this question, because it has got so many ramifications in different directions. The result of this attitude of Hawking's and also that of Lawrence Krauss and various other people, is that many students and professors are told that they must choose between science and God. That if you want to be regarded as a serious intellectual, then you've got to choose between science and God. Now, I was put under that pressure. I've been asked to be personal, so I'll say one or two personal things. I met that pressure from the highest level at the age of 19, when I sat by accident beside a Nobel Prize winner at a dinner in Cambridge. I was in my second year. And I talked to him, rather pathetically, I imagine, about my faith in God. And after dinner, he invited me to his room with three other professors, no students, sat me in a chair. And he said, "Lennox, do you want a career in science?" I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Well, in front of witnesses tonight, give up this pathetic belief in God. Because I tell you, it will cripple you. It will mean that you will never make any significant progress in your career. So give it up right away, right now." That was pressure. I was an undergraduate. I'd only started. So I looked at him and said, "Sir, what do you have to offer me that's better than what I've got?" And he came out with something that many of you will never have heard of, Bergson's theory of evolutionism. And when I heard it, I knew about the theory. I said, "Sir, if that's all you got, I'm going to take the risk." Now that pressure, that was a turning point in my life, of course. Because I decided if that is the kind of way in which we're to be treated in the world of Cambridge, there's something seriously wrong with the worldviews that are espoused in the academy. So that's just a little bit of background. Why is it that Newton allies gravity to God and Hawking says you've got to choose between God and gravity essentially? I want to suggest it is to do with confusion that has generated a very deep intellectual fog. So I'm about to describe that fog to you. Now, I am passionate about science, but science needs a health warning, because what's causing a lot of the difficulty is not science, of course, but it's scientism. That is the view that science is the only way to truth. And of course, that is logical nonsense, as well as being very silly, because if science is the only way to truth, you'd better close half your faculties in this university tomorrow. But the statement, science is the only way to truth, is not a statement of science. So if it's true, it's false. Perhaps it's too late at night for logic like that, but there we are. It is absurd, actually. And serious scientists realize that we do science a disservice, as Sir Peter Medawar put it, if we claim it's the only way to truth. And he wrote, "The existence of a limit to science is, however, made clear by its inability to answer childlike elementary questions having to do with first and last things. Questions such as, how did everything begin? What are we all here for? What is the point of living?" A better name for scientism is scientific fundamentalism. That sharpens the debate up a great deal. And I'm a passionate scientist, but I'm passionately opposed to scientific fundamentalism. And one of the very important things to say in that statements by scientists are not necessarily statements of science. Late Carl Sagan started a famous television series, Cosmos, with the words, "The universe is all there is, was, or ever shall be." That is a statement by a scientist. It's not a statement of science. It's a statement of his own atheistic, materialistic belief, full stop. And we need to realize this, because we live in a culture where, on the one hand, science has rightly got great authority. It has produced the iPhone, for goodness sake. So it's got great cultural authority, but we attribute to people who are scientific experts authority in all other realms. We need to listen to the Nobel Prize winner Richard Feynman. He said, when he goes outside his subject, the scientist is just as dumb as the next guy. And it's very important to realize that. Einstein realized it when he wrote, "The scientist is a poor philosopher." And what I'm going to suggest, rather provocatively, is we've got a whole range of very poor philosophers as scientists in our universities in the Western world today. But let's start, because one of the dangers of scientism is that people come to believe that science is coextensive with rationality. And therefore, they then put belief in God in the same category as belief in Santa Claus. I keep being accused of believing in Santa Claus, God, you know, and it's slightly irritating. When it comes from intelligent people, I was at the University of Groningen, I think it was, or Delft in the Netherlands, recently debating a physicist. And this was what he said. It was the first thing he said, you know, "Lennox believes in God, that's like belief in Santa Claus." And I stopped him right there. And I put it to the audience. I said, "Ladies and gentlemen, let's test this, shall we? How many of you came to believe in Santa Claus as adults?" And there were a couple of thousand people there. There wasn't a hand went up. And then I said, "How many of you came to believe in God as adults?" Many hundreds of hands went up. And then I made the point, please don't insult our intelligence. Some of the finest minds in history have spent hundreds, if not thousands of years thinking about the majesty of God and the way in which understanding God fits into all the other disciplines. They haven't done the same with Santa Claus. So please don't insult our intelligence by putting them in the same category. Now, of course, the subtext of this is Freud, the idea that belief in God is wish fulfillment. Now, this is going into the realm of psychology and is usually the first scientific approach that stops the debate flat. The God Delusion is the title of Richard Dawkins' book. Delusion is a psychological, indeed a psychiatric term. Now, you see, Richard Dawkins is not a psychiatrist, and neither am I. So what do? When we go outside our own field, we check with the experts. I did, he didn't. Because if you check with the top psychiatrists in the world, you'll find statements like this from our president of the Royal College of Psychiatrists. "The positive benefit of belief in God is the best kept secret of psychiatry." If the results of studies of studies, not just studies, had gone the opposite direction, it would have been front page headlines all throughout the world. But because it doesn't, they keep it quiet. Dawkins doesn't appear to know that. That's point number one. Point number two is, the logic of the Freudian argument is deeply flawed. You see, if there is no God, and I base my argument on Manfred Lutz, who's one of the leading German psychiatrists. He wrote a book called Eine kleine Geschichte des Größten. It's not in English yet, A Brief History of the Great One, so you'll have to learn German if you want to read it. But Manfred Lutz makes the point, if there is no God, Freud gives you a brilliant argument to demonstrate that faith in God is a delusion, a wish fulfillment, a father figure in the sky, if there is no God. Of course, he said, if there is a God, then the exact same argument shows you how atheism is a delusion. The delusory idea that we'll never have to meet God and give account for the mess we've made of our own lives and those of others. And then he gives the bottom line. He says, as to the substantive question, whether there is a God or not, Freud can't help you, neither can Jung, neither can Frankl. You'll have to look elsewhere. You see, Freud is a double-edged sword. If you forgive another personal reference, Stephen Hawking was asked some time ago by one of our national papers what he thought of religion. He said, religion is a fairy story for people afraid of the dark. And they very kindly asked me to comment. And I said, do you want a one-liner? They said, oh, we'd love a one-liner. So I said, how about this? Atheism is a fairy story for people afraid of the light. Now, your clapping shows that you didn't follow the argument, because the point I'm making is neither of the statements prove anything at all. But never mind, it was nice to get a cheer. So we need to go deeper than this. Why should we choose science and not God. Now, the confusion here has to do with two disciplines. One is theology, the nature of God, and the other is science. You see, I used to think that when I mentioned the word God, people understood that I was talking about the triune eternal God of the Bible, who's the creator and upholder of the universe. That's no longer the case. It's far more likely that people like Hawking and so on, when they hear the word God, think of a Greek god, like the god of lightning. Now, the thing about the god of lightning is that she or he was a science stopper. In other words, if you thought lightning was a god, you better not study it. You might upset the god. And a simple course in atmospheric physics at ASU will dismiss that god completely. The Greek god of lightning is a so-called god of the gaps. I can't explain it, therefore God did it, that kind of God. Now, to my amazement, many of my scientific colleagues around the world think that that's what I believe. That there are things in life I meet, I can't explain them, therefore I postulate God. So that, as science advances, it fills those gaps and God disappears. Now listen to this very carefully. If that's what you think of God, then you've got to choose between science and God, because that's how you've defined God. Have you got that? If you think of God as a God of the gaps, an X, a placeholder, until science comes up with some kind of explanation, you've got to choose between science and God, because that's the way you've defined God. And one of the main problems in this debate is not science, it's the definition of God. As I pointed out to Dawkins, much to his irritation, the God he didn't believe in, I don't believe in either. And it's a very important thing to say, because the God of the Bible, well, you've probably read the first line of the Bible, it's very interesting. It says, in the beginning God created the bits of the universe we don't understand. Doesn't it? No, apparently not. In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, which in Hebrew is Emeritus. Meaning everything, the whole show, the bits we understand, the bits we don't. So when Newton discovered his law of gravity, he didn't say, oh, marvelous, I've got a scientific explanation, I don't need God. Of course he didn't. He said, what a marvelous God to do it that way. Because the more he understood of the universe, the more he admired the genius of the God that did it that way. And that's the way your mind works, doesn't it? You're studying engineering here. The more you know of engineering, the more you can admire the engine of a Rolls-Royce or a turbojet, not the less. You're studying fine art, the more you know about art and painting, the more you can admire the genius of a Rubens, not the less. This is an absurd argument. We've got to realize that the God claimed by Christians and the three great monotheistic religions is not a God of the gaps. He doesn't disappear on the advance of science. In fact, it's the other way round. We gain more understanding of him the more we do science. This is a massively important thing, because it seems to me one of the main reasons that many scientists think that you have to choose between science and God. Now let me flip to the science side. The whole thing really could be regarded as studying the nature of explanation. Science explains. What does that actually mean? Science explains. Well, let's think about it. I was told at school about the law of gravity. I love the law of gravity. It's a wonderful thing to show students how the elliptical orbits of the planets around the sun come from an equation with only 8 symbols in it. I mean, that's phenomenal stuff, that is. But you see, I made a mistake at school. I thought the law of gravity told me what gravity was. It doesn't, you know. Nobody knows what gravity is. If you don't believe that, read Nobel Prize winner Richard Feynman. You see, we get into a way of thinking that when the word science explains comes, that we're getting a total explanation, even within the realm of science, when we're not. The law of gravity is brilliant. It enables you to land people on the moon, even without Einstein's corrections. It doesn't tell you what gravity is. In fact, it was a philosopher, Ludwig Wittgenstein, who made the very profound point on this. He said the greatest deception of modernism is that the laws of nature are explanations of the phenomena of nature. They're not. They are simply descriptions of what normally happens. Now, this is absolutely revolutionary if we get a hold of it. It means that a law of nature only explains at a certain level. Now, let's go to the next step. Why is the water boiling? Well, it isn't actually, but why is it boiling? Well, it's boiling because the heat energy from the Bunsen flame is being conducted through the copper base of the kettle, and the molecules of water are getting agitated and so on. That's why it's boiling. Nonsense. It's boiling because I want a cup of tea. Now, this is very profound stuff, isn't it? But it's fascinating. Would you ever dream of saying I was right and saying nonsense? Two explanations are necessary for the boiling of that water, not one. There's a scientific explanation, and then there is the explanation in terms of what we may call agent intention. I want a cup of tea. Now, think about it. The physics explanation is important, but people have been brewing tea for thousands of years before they knew anything about the nature of heat. Actually, the brewing of the tea and the wanting of the tea is far more important to most of us, isn't it? Except in physics classes. And it would be utterly absurd to suggest that the scientific explanation tells you everything about that boiling water. It is utterly absurd, ladies and gentlemen, to suggest that science tells you everything about the universe. Let me put this very carefully. Science is no more in competition with God as explanation than the law of internal combustion is in competition with Henry Ford as an explanation for the motor car. Have you got that? There is more than one kind of explanation. And the point is, God, peace be to Richard Dawkins, is not the same kind of explanation as science. In fact, a colleague at Oxford, Richard Swinburne, says science explains, but I postulate God to explain why science explains. You see, people often suggest that, you know, Laplace, the famous mathematician who met Napoleon, and Napoleon said, looking at these equations for ballistics, said, where is God in your equations, Mr. Laplace? And Laplace replied, je n'ai pas besoin de cette hypothèse. I don't need that hypothesis. And there's the end of God. But that's absurd. When the Higgs boson was discovered, Lawrence Krauss wrote a little article to say that the Higgs boson was arguably more important than God. I wrote a little article in reply, which was published in one of our national papers. I said, arguably more relevant than God, for what? Certainly, if you're doing atomic physics, the Higgs boson is much more relevant than God. But if you're asking the question, why is there a universe at all in which particle physics can be done, God is very much more important than the Higgs boson. This is making a fundamental and elementary philosophical mistake. Either or, it's failing to recognize the two different levels of explanation. Now, I find kids at school can understand this. I find many professors, and I'm being honest with you, cannot, because they've totally bought into the idea that the only level of explanation possible is a scientific one. And it's manifestly false, and it leads into a huge fault. Let me put it this way. Mechanism and agency is one way to describe things. And then on the other hand, we have got agency. So the idea that God and science are incompatible results from two profound and very simple mistakes. One, the nature of God. God is not a God of the gaps. to the nature of scientific explanation. It's only one level. But the fog gets denser, I'm afraid. The next problem is the nature of faith. Atheists have no faith, wrote Richard Dawkins, and then wrote a book on what he believes. Hitchens, our beliefs are not a belief, our faith is not a faith. What? But where does it come from? It comes from a subtle redefinition of the concept of faith that many people have bought into. Webster's Dictionary, new entry. Faith, noun, believing where there's no evidence. That isn't faith, ladies and gentlemen, that's blind faith. Ordinary faith, fides, Latin, loyalty, trust, is the kind of thing that we all know about in our life. You know why you trust your friends. Your bank manager will want to know why he can trust you to give you a loan or a mortgage. Everybody in the Western world knows what evidence-based faith means. And you're a fool to believe something without any evidence. If I say I believe that or I trust that, the next logical question is why? On what basis? Now you see what's happened very subtly, led by Dawkins and others, is to redefine faith as a purely religious word, which it isn't, it's an ordinary word, meaning believing where there's no evidence. That is desperately wrong and dangerous. Now, I must speak as a Christian. Other religious traditions must rightly speak for themselves, but Christianity is an evidence-based faith. I can demonstrate that just in a moment. Because one of the central claims of, say, the Gospel of John is many other signs Jesus did that are not written in this book, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life in his name. In other words, here are the signs, the semeion, from which we get semiotics, the indicators on which faith is based. I wouldn't sit here for a microsecond if I didn't believe that my Christian faith is based on evidence. That's one side of the story. But now we come to the other side. What this is confusion has caused is people overlook totally the fact that faith is essential to science. Absolutely essential. Einstein once said, I cannot imagine a real scientist without that faith. Now, he didn't mean faith in God. He meant faith in the rational intelligibility of the universe. He meant that conviction that drove Galileo, Kepler, Newton, Clerk Maxwell, and so on. They believed that the universe was intelligible because they believed in God. But leave God out of it. You cannot do science. You can't even start to do science without believing it can be done. That is your belief. Now, you give evidence for it, of course. But I was taught quantum physics by Professor Sir John Polkinghorne, and he reminds us in his books that physics is powerless to explain its faith in the rational intelligibility of the universe for the simple reason that you have to believe that before you start. So here's the fascinating thing. People write me off, at least Dawkins does, I'm a man of faith, which means I believe that there's no evidence, but he's a man of faith. And this is illustrated brilliantly in my debate with Peter Singer, who's the world's most famous bioethicist from Princeton. I debated him in Australia. And I usually tell audiences that I have a worldview. My parents were Christians, so were my grandparents. And of course, I get written off because then my Christianity is Irish genetics, full stop. Well, okay, I was honest about that and can discuss that if you want to question it. And Peter Singer stood up and he said, well, there goes my biggest objection to all religion. People just stay in the faith in which they were brought up, you see. So I thought, this is going to be very interesting. So when I had a chance to speak, I said, Peter, I told them about my background, that I first met my worldview from my parents who lived it, and then I tested it in all kinds of other ways later. But what about you? Were your parents atheists? He said, yes, they were. Oh, I said, that's very interesting. You have stayed in the faith in which you were brought up. Oh, but he said, it isn't a faith. Oh, I said, Peter, I'm desperately sorry. I was under the impression you believed it. Now, cyberspace went wild because here was one of the world's leading philosophers that doesn't recognize his atheism as a belief system. Ladies and gentlemen, that's serious. And it's come about by this redefinition of faith. Real faith is not blind faith. It's a commitment either to facts or people or all kinds of other things based on evidence. And it's only as strong and viable as the evidence that stands behind it. But it's absolutely essential to science. The new definition obscures that, so they asked me to give talks on science and faith, as if the two things had nothing to do with one another. I don't do talks like that, I do talks like this. Now here's the interesting thing. Eugen Wigner is a great hero to mathematicians because he wrote an article entitled The Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics. How is it that here's a mathematician, she's thinking in here about the universe out there, and she comes up with an equation that appears to describe gravitational waves or something like this, and it seems to work. How does that work? And he was amazed. He said, it's unreasonable. I say it is, on the assumption of atheism. Now we come to something very interesting. I have lots of fun in Oxford. It's a very stimulating place, as I've discovered is your university here. I asked my colleagues who are scientists what they do science with, and they say, well, I've got this billion-dollar machine. No. Oh, you mean my, and they're about to say mind, when they remember there's no such thing as the mind, and they say, you mean my brain. Well, actually, I think there is such a thing as the mind, but let it stand. I say, okay, you do science with your brain. Tell me about your brain that you do science with. What's the short story, really? This is about the story of the brain. Well, often the answer comes back like this. Well, in the end, the brain is simply the end product of an unguided process. Oh, really? And you trust it? That's a very embarrassing question to ask, you know. You might be interested to know that the first person that suggested that difficulty was Charles Darwin. He wrote, with me the horrid doubt always arises whether the convictions of man's mind, which has been developed, as I believe, from the mind of the lower animals, are of any value or at all trustworthy. Now here I'm going to develop the thesis that science destroys atheism. Because atheism undermines the necessary trust in the capacity of the human brain or mind to be rational. And it is remarkable and interesting to me that this is coming now into mainstream in the argument because atheists are beginning to say it. Let me quote first one of the world's top class Christian philosophers, Alvin Plantinga of Notre Dame. If Dawkins is right, that we are the product of mindless, unguided natural processes, then he has given a strong reason to doubt the reliability of human cognitive faculties, and therefore inevitably to doubt the validity of any belief they produce, including Dawkins' own science and atheism. His biology and his belief in naturalism would therefore appear to be at war with each other in a conflict that has nothing to do with God. Now, massively significantly, is the writing of Thomas Nagel, one of the most brilliant philosophers, and a hard atheist. He doesn't want there to be a God. But he is now writing in a book called Mind and Cosmos with the most explosive subtitle you'll ever read. Why the Neo-Darwinian View of the World is Almost Certainly False. How's that for a subtitle for a book in the 21st century? But listen to what he says. If the mental is not itself merely physical, it cannot be fully explained by physical science. Evolutionary naturalism implies that we shouldn't take any of our convictions seriously, including the scientific world picture on which evolutionary naturalism depends. In other words, to put it bluntly, the philosophy of atheistic naturalism doesn't simply shoot itself in the foot, which is quite painful. It shoots itself in the brain, which is fatal. Now that's really a major point. And it means, of course, ladies and gentlemen, my main objections to atheism are not because I'm a Christian. I mean, that's automatically so. Because I'm a scientist. I cannot believe a theory that undermines the tools I need for my science. C.S. Lewis saw it brilliantly in the 1940s. He said, we've done brilliant science because we thought about the natural world, but we haven't thought about thinking. And if we begin to think about thinking and develop theories that undermine the validity of thinking itself, they cannot be true because they are mutually self-contradictory. Now, all I've been talking about so far is the philosophy of science. I haven't really mentioned a single result because I think here's where the important arguments lie. But perhaps just in conclusion, I will mention one or two of the results of science because they are of great interest around this place and elsewhere in the world. The standard model of the universe means that there is a beginning. And so we have to face the fact that there's a singularity. And the most recent results of Bord, Vilenkin, and Guth are the world authorities in this, mathematicians and theoretical astronomers. It is said that an argument is what convinces reasonable men, and a proof is what it takes to convince even an unreasonable man. With the proof now in place, cosmologists can no longer hide behind the possibility of a past eternal universe. There is no escape. They have to face the problem of a cosmic beginning. So they have to get a universe from nothing. Now you see, as a Christian, I don't have a problem with this because the universe came from nothing physical, but it didn't come from nothing. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and God is spirit. He's not physical, but he's not nothing. But let's get rid of God now. And the wonder of modern science is we are now forced into a corner because we've got to get God from nothing. Now listen to Hawking's attempt to do that. This is his book, The Grand Design. This is his central statement. Because there is a law of gravity, the universe can and will create itself from nothing. Pardon? Let's try that again. Because there is a law of gravity, because there is something, the universe can and will create itself from nothing. Flat contradiction number one. But it's worse than that. Because there is a law of gravity, he doesn't say because gravity exists, and now opens up this can of worms. It's a very interesting can of worms. The worms are very fat and interesting. the idea that laws can create something. That's absurd, ladies and gentlemen. In fact, the financial crisis occurred because some people thought mathematics can create money. Lewis saw it years ago. 1 + 1 = 2. But adding up won't give you, well, let me give you an illustration of it. Peter Atkins is a very famous physical chemist and a pretty contrarian atheist. And I've debated him as well. And I asked him, what do you think created the universe, Peter? And he said, mathematics. And I'm afraid I was very rude. I laughed. And he said, what are you laughing at? He said, look, Peter, I'm sorry. I am a mathematician. That must be the silliest thing I've ever heard. He said, why? Well, let me put it to you simply. 1 + 1 = 2. Did that ever put £2 in your pocket? The idea that by doing sums you can create something physical is nonsense. Because science is an abstract discipline. Mathematics is an abstract discipline. And as Lewis points out, the average law is if you got A, you'll get B, but you've got to catch A in the first place in order to get your B. This is elementary stuff because there is a law of gravity. But what on earth anyway would a law of gravity mean if there's no such thing as gravity? So that's the second major point. The third is even worse. The universe will create itself. Well, now, abstract from that. I love language, you know, and logic. X creates Y. What does that mean? Well, roughly speaking, if you've got X, you'll get Y. X creates X. If you've got X, you'll get X. And what does that mean? It means, ladies and gentlemen, that nonsense remains nonsense even if scientists talk it. It is utterly absurd. This is an attempt to get a universe from nothing. It does no such thing. Now, how can you get a universe from nothing? With great difficulty. But one of the things to do is redefine nothing, as Lawrence Krauss does. What would you say to somebody that wrote this in an essay given to you? Because something is physical, nothing must be physical, especially if you define it as the absence of something. What? That's on page 5 of Krauss's book, A Universe from Nothing. It's philosophical nonsense, ladies and gentlemen. Philosophical nonsense. Now, I find this very interesting. God gets rejected. The science tells us that there's a singularity at which space-time arose. So you've got to get a universe from nothing. The attempts border on the ridiculous and the absurd. But I'm very fortunate. I get to debate some very interesting people. One of them was Alan Guth at the Harvard-MIT Faculty Club. He's the author of The Theory of Inflation. He's one of the world's top cosmologists. So I said to him, a very friendly discussion, I said, Alan, tell me, I said, when you astrophysicists use the word nothing, you don't mean it in the ordinary philosophical down-to-earth sense of absence of anything. He said, of course we don't. I said, thank you very much. And if you look at the books carefully that claim to get a universe from nothing, they do no such thing. And the philosophers have had a field day with it. Because you see, Hawking is a brilliant scientist. But he hasn't a clue about philosophy. At the beginning of this book in which he makes this statement, he says, philosophy is dead. And then he writes a book on the philosophy of science. It really, and I'm stressing this because it disturbs me greatly, that this kind of stuff is being marketed as serious science when it is logical nonsense. Now, the final point. Well, there are many points, but I'm going to stop so as you can have questions. I said I'd go about 45 minutes. I'm going to transgress that very slightly. Ladies and gentlemen, the other thing about explanation is this. We are often taught that explanation, to be genuine, must go from the simple to the complex. Is that a thing you're familiar with? We call it reductionism. You reduce things to the simplest physics and chemistry. And of course, the main aim of physical reductionism is to reduce everything to physics and chemistry. And it's very successful in certain areas. There's one area it doesn't work, and that is the area of language. If you see anything written, you see the word veritas, you immediately know that whatever automatic processes or natural processes have gone into producing that, there's a mind behind it. And you recognize that just from a few letters. And I often have, well, fun with my colleagues who study DNA. And I pick up who are reductionists, and one example comes to mind that'll explain everything. I was sitting at table in my college having a lovely dinner with a man who didn't like to sit beside me because he found out I was a pure mathematician and said that was very boring. And then when I tried to compensate and say I was interested in the deep questions of life, like the status of the universe, he said that's even worse. Because I'm a reductionist, I'm an atheist, we've nothing to talk about. And I said, but we have actually. I'm fascinated by reductionism. I know at least three kinds. What kind are you? So we agreed that methodological reductionism, splitting a big problem into a little problem, was a good thing to do. And solve the little problems and get insight. But he said, that's not what I mean. No, I said, I know it's not what you mean. You're an ontological reductionist. You believe everything can be reduced to physics and chemistry. He said, absolutely. So I said, let's do an experiment. And I picked up the menu. He said, an experiment? I said, of course, this is Oxford. And he read it out. It said roast chicken. It wasn't very imaginative. It wasn't even written in French. And he said, roast chicken, what's the problem? I said, none from my perspective, but you're a reductionist. Yes, everything in terms of physics and chemistry. Yes, he said. Okay, I said, explain to me the semiotics of these marks R-O-A-S-T, in terms of the physics and chemistry of the paper and ink. And there was silence. And his wife was beside him, and rather embarrassingly, she said, "Get out of that if you can." But he didn't try. He was stunningly honest. He said, "You know," he said, "I've gone into my lab in Oxford," and he's a world-class biochemist, "for 40 years every day believing that could be done." It was stunning. And I was so amazed. I said, "But physics and chemistry have only been going for a few years." He said, "It doesn't matter. It's not within the power of physics and chemistry to deal with the meaning." And then he looked at me a bit worriedly. He said, "Where did you get that argument?" I said, "It's okay, I got it from a Nobel Prize winner." Oh, he said, "What a relief." But it gets worse, ladies and gentlemen. He studies DNA. That's the longest word we've ever discovered. 4.3.5 billion letters in exactly the right order. What about that? "Oh, a chance and necessity." I said, "What? You see five letters of roast and you immediately postulate mind. You see 3.5 billion letters in the right order. And you're forced by what? Science or materialist philosophy to say that no mind is involved?" I find that extremely odd. Ladies and gentlemen, I come to a stop and I say this. We've looked at two worldviews very briefly. One of them starts with mass energy or nothing. Let's start with nothing. That's the popular view. On the other side of the equation, there's God. So we're actually faced with a choice between God and nothing. And the worldview that I believe fits brilliantly with contemporary science in a way in which our forebears would never have realized goes like this. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things came to be through Him." Those are existence statements. The Word already was, the Word exists eternally, and all else is derivative. The contemporary view, which I reject totally, both as a scientist and a Christian, is in the beginning there was nothing and all else derives from that. Ladies and gentlemen, universities are a good place to find out which to choose. Thank you very much indeed. Now I face the ultimate test to try and use this iPad to answer a couple of questions. Right, well, we'll look at these for a minute. The Bible says the world is a few thousand years old. I wonder where that question came from. The Bible says the world is a few thousand years old from Genesis. Yet lots of fossils have been dated to be much, and then I can't read anything else because it's over here. Well, the first statement I believe to be false, ladies and gentlemen. Now, I realize this is a question, it's really an in-house question, and in one sense it's got very little to do with our topic.
I was told to scroll down.
No, it's okay, it's sideways actually is the problem. But since the question has been asked, would you like me to say something about this question? You would? Okay, let me do it very briefly. This has created a lot of sad dissent among Christians. Now, if you're not a Christian, I'd like you to close your ears and not listen to this, because it's not a pretty picture, actually. But it is very sad to see Christians who are equally convinced of the major doctrines of Christianity, that there is a creator, that Christ is God incarnate, that he did miracles, etc., etc., and so on. They agree on all of that, but they disagree on the interpretation of the first page of the Bible. That ought to tell us that there's a problem. And there is a problem. And in one sense, the question as asked is very simple to resolve. That's the amazing thing. Because What I do when I meet this kind of thing, and unfortunately it has had the effect of turning many young people away from science, because they love science and then they're told that they've got to believe the earth is young because their pastor says so, and then they do the splits, and I meet many of them who have lost their faith, and I thought it's important to do something about this. But ladies and gentlemen, the question as it stands is very simple to resolve. Let me try to do so. The text of Genesis says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. When was that? Well, in the literary structure of the first chapter, there now follows a sequence of days. You're aware of that, don't you? Day one, day two, day three, day four, day five, day six, and then God rests. Each of the days begins with the statement, and God said. So the beginning is not on day one. Can you establish that any other way? Of course. Hebrew has different past tenses. And the first two verses of the Bible are in one past tense. And the sequence of days are in another past tense. And to be fair, I consulted the professors of Hebrew in Oxford and the professor of Hebrew in Cambridge. And they agreed, which is marvelous. And they pointed out to me that the difference in those tenses means that the first initial statement is a statement about something that happened at an indefinite period before the sequence of days. That's the end of it. The Bible says nothing about the age of the earth or the universe. Isn't that odd that there's been so much fighting about it? Now you see, that's irrespective of what you believe about the days. Because if the beginning is before the sequence of days, at an indefinite period, you may have different views about the days, but they don't affect the question. Isn't it a pity that so many people have been put off Christianity by arguing about this? Now, there's more to it, and I'm going to do a bit of shameless advertising. But because I love students over here so much, I've written a book about this. It's called 7 Days That Divide the World. And you can get it on Kindle or Amazon or anything you like. And there I go into these questions in very great detail. So that's all I'd say about this. What are a few mathematical secrets equations hidden in the Bible? I know of none. I think one of the problems has been, in the past, when I was a youth, there were people who wrote things saying, if you add up the letters, you get all sorts of this and that and the other thing. It never convinced anybody. And it was totally devastated when a very bright Christian wrote a similar analysis of a child's poem, 3 Blind Mice, and discovered the same kind of patterns, and that ended the whole thing. Biblical work is there to understand the arguments and what it actually says, not as a kind of Kabbalistic secret document in which we can suddenly unveil the secrets of the universe. The interesting thing is, many of the people who spend a lot of time on those kind of Kabbalistic things don't believe what the Bible actually says. And it's much more important not to lose a sense of proportion. Now, what scientifically or mathematical evidences are there to support the existence of a supreme God? What historical evidence do you know that backs up that Jesus was on earth? Well, the answer to the first question, I spent nearly 50 minutes giving you a little taster of it, that one of the major evidences to me that there is a God is that we can do science. To go further than that, I would say that we are also moral beings, made in the image of God. We're rational beings, we're moral beings. And both of those things point to something transcendent. Because just as I do not believe you can get rationality from irrationality by natural, unguided processes, so I do not believe you can get morality from non-morality by unguided natural processes. Now, one of the forces of the question is that looking at science, as I've been asked to do tonight, only gets you so far. The Bible admits that. The Apostle Paul writes about nature. And he says, you know, nature is a powerful witness to the existence of God. The invisible things, he says, of God and his power are seen in the things that are made. And he goes on to make a very provocative statement. He says this witness, this evidence in nature is so powerful that people are without excuse for ignoring it. That is evidence, by the way, to my mind, in the absurdities people will go to avoid the conclusion. It's a perception. And it is very interesting that even people like Dawkins have that perception. So does Hawking. It is terribly, terribly tempting, he says, to believe that there's a God behind him. Of course it is, because there is a God behind it. But he's not prepared to go there. It's very interesting. Stephen Hawking says, look, we find this universe fine-tuned. And the long evidences of fine-tuning, and some of us might be tempted to go to the old view, he says, that there is a creator. That's chronological snobbery of the first order. It's old, therefore it must be false. What nonsense. This is not science talk. This is nonsense. So the evidence is there. It's the way you treat that evidence. Now, I've written a book on God and Stephen Hawking that teases out some of these things, so I'll have to leave it there. What historical evidence do you know that backs up that Jesus was on earth? Now, this is the most interesting thing. Take the God delusion. And this is an example of what I mean by people not checking out the disciplines into which they wander. Now, I'm aware that I'm a pure mathematician talking to you, not about pure mathematics tonight. I'm wandering into all kinds of other areas, but the reason I'm prepared to do that is I trust I've checked out every detail. Every detail. But listen to Dawkins and the God delusion. A good case can be made out for the fact that Jesus never existed, although I myself don't accept it. And there's a professor in London who makes this good case out. He doesn't tell us that the professor is a retired professor of German literature. But that's absurd, ladies and gentlemen. Ancient history is the discipline. You won't find, as far as I know, a reputable ancient historian that doesn't believe that Jesus existed. And in fact, even the most skeptical, like Gerd Ludemann in Germany and so on, has a whole list of things about the life of Jesus that he regards as essentially certain. When you check with the experts, you find it doesn't support the wild allegations in books like The God Delusion. Now, if the person asks me this question is serious about it, they will check out the evidence. You see, this is a Q&A, ladies and gentlemen, so it's desperately inadequate. All I can do is give you my instant reaction to questions. That's good, because the main work is what you do if your question was serious and not just trying to test me. That happens sometimes, you know. Is what you do and go back and really dig into this question, and it'll become important to you. That's what a university is about. I don't think science, has buried an impersonal God, but seems to bury a personal God. Any thoughts on this distinction? Yes. I presume you want me to tell you what they are. I don't think that science has buried impersonal gods. I do, actually. I think a lot of these impersonal gods of the Greeks have been buried pretty well by scientific discovery, because the fact, again, I repeat it, that the universe is rationally intelligent speaks of person in any sense in which we understand that. In the beginning was the Word. And Genesis is very careful to fill out the concept of God by a whole series of verbs. God saw. God saw it was good. God blessed. And so on. God said, these are all things that we predicate of person. So I think the exact opposite to you. But of course, the evidence is, and it links with the previous question, the evidence stops in the sense that, as Paul said, you can deduce from nature that there is a powerful God, full stop. If you want to know any more about God, Then, of course, there is the issue of revelation. I believe in revelation. The moment I say that, I will be accused by certain people who live not far from here. I shall be accused of losing my reason. But that is very silly. Do you know, if you want to get to know me, you could put me on this table and have tie me up to electroencephalographs. You could give me a CAT scan. You could do all kinds of things. You'll never get to know me. You can study the science of John Lennox and write 1,000 books on it. You'll never know him. The only way you'll get to know me is if I reveal myself to you. Now, how will I do that normally? By speaking. And of course, that shuts your reason off, does it? Don't be silly. You use your reason on what I reveal. But if I don't reveal it, your reason will never discover it. Do you see that? It's exactly the same with God. Now, logically to me, if there is a God who created us, it's a logical possibility, at least, that he might want to get to know us. And the magnificent claim of Christianity now is specific. And you've asked me about Christ. It wasn't in the title of my talk, but you've asked me, so I'd better give you a personal answer. Is that all right? It is? Good. Christ is the supreme evidence to me of the detailed nature of God and how we can get to know him. That's a far bigger thing than doing mathematics, you know. Mathematics is fun. Getting to know God is life. That's a huge possibility that is offered to us. Now, let me look briefly at these things to see how many thousand more there are. How can we as college-age Christians deal with the growing indifference and religious apathy from our peers and help spark an interest in those who don't care? That's not an easy question to answer because it's a general question, but it's a very important question to treat. First of all, if you are a Christian, and again, those who are not, don't need to listen to this, be real. Now, what do I mean by being real? Make sure your Christianity is reflected in your moral integrity and the way you live. Otherwise, it won't be credible. That's number one. Secondly, obey the first commandment, which is to love the Lord with your mind. There are lots of people engaged in Christian activity, but they're not engaged in Christian thought. And if ever we're going to open up a university like this, we must show that we can have something to say, something that's intelligent, something that has explanatory power, something that deals with the big questions of life. Now, that's problematic because we're just young students. We don't know everything. And even when you reach over 70 like me, you don't know everything. I meet people virtually every day who ask me questions I don't understand. Being real means you say you don't understand them and you don't know the answers. But you say, look, could we meet for coffee next Tuesday and I'm going to think about this? I tell you, you'll think hard before next Tuesday. And you'll make a friend because they'll see that you're human. You don't know everything. And what I do, still, you see, ladies and gentlemen, I mentioned to you where I come from. I come from a strong Christian background. How do I know it's not just Freud? Well, because I've spent my entire life exposing my faith in God to its opposite. All around the world, particularly in communist countries where I could study the immediate effect of atheism on cultures and communities. Why did I do that? Because I want to know. I want to know whether it's true or not, not whether it's helpful or not. And you need to engage and be serious. Now, the Apostle Peter has a bit of advice for Christians. He says, always be ready to give an answer to people that ask you for a reason for the hope that is within you. Please notice what that's not saying. It doesn't say, always be ready to give a long, preachy message to people that don't want to hear it. Always be ready to give an answer to those that ask you. He's envisaging dialogue where the questions are not coming from you. How do you stimulate that kind of thing? By learning to ask questions. Play Socrates. What sort of questions? All sorts of simple questions. Get to know people. And I have a simple rule that I break all the time because I'm Irish. And that is when I meet somebody new, I keep asking them questions until they ask me one. That's the way to get to know people. Some of us who are Christian are so keen to deliver a message, we ram it down people's throats whether they want it or not. That isn't the way to behave. It's so important to regard people. You see, my father taught me that every person in the world, whether they believe in God or not, is made in the image of God and is therefore of infinite value. I take that so seriously. And that's why I spend a lot of time listening. I was also taught that I've got two ears and one mouth, and I should use them in that proportion. Okay, how much more time have we got? Can I ask the moderators? When are we supposed to stop? Oh, right, okay. Well, the hard question has just come up. I still would like to hear a solid rational argument as to why tragedy and evil are so prevalent in our world. And another question is, why are you a Christian and not something else? So let me just try and face that very quickly. This is the hardest question of all. I still would like to hear a rational argument about evil, but our topic was not evil, ladies and gentlemen. So I'm under pressure. It's nothing to do with the topic, but would you like me to say something briefly about this? Because it's the really hard question. Let me say, first of all, that if you want to hear more, Google my name in New Zealand, because I arrived in New Zealand 2 days before the earthquake, 2 days after the earthquake, and had to give lectures on why earthquakes to everybody. But very, very quickly, and this is going to be desperate, this problem is a twin problem. There's moral evil, the bad things people do to one another. And there's pain, what the universe does to people. Tumors, cancers, and so on. There are then two perspectives. It's one thing to be a professor of oncology. It's another thing to be told you've 3 months to live because you've got cancer. And I know in a big audience like this, there are people who are hurting. Hurting because of what nature is doing to them, or hurting because of the way they've been treated by other people and abused and so on. So I'm very sensitive to that. That's why I'd like an hour to answer this, but I haven't got an hour. So let me try and say something helpful that I found has helped me and many other people. I understand people who become atheists because of this. I've stood in Auschwitz many times and I've wept every time. You watch ISIS, you watch what's happening in the world to abuse children, and it just blows your mind. I understand people who become atheists because of it. But very gently, I'd just like to point out that if that's your position, it may have solved an intellectual problem in your mind. That's just the way the universe is. Richard Dawkins says, this universe is just like we'd expect it to be. If at bottom there's no good, no evil, no justice. DNA just is, and we dance to its music. Now you'll see clearly there, that's the abolition of all morality. That's the logical consequence of atheism, by the way. And he takes it in that statement, although he rebels against it elsewhere. So the person that says there's no God because of the problem of evil and suffering, they've got rid of God, but they haven't got rid of the suffering. In fact, you could understand that they could have made it 10,000 times worse because they've got rid of all hope. Because the atheist position is that death is the end. Now we need to face what that means, ladies and gentlemen. If death is the end, the vast majority of human beings who've ever lived or who are alive at this moment on this planet will never see justice. Do you realize that? And yet, in the fiber of our humanness, we feel there must be justice somewhere. Now, I'm going to cut a very long story short. I have problems with this. Of course I do, because I watch suffering. My brother was nearly killed by a terrorist bomb and all this kind of stuff. But when I come down to it, the only window I can see into it goes like this. The central Christian claim. Now, what I would ask you to do if you're not a Christian is simply to listen to what I say. You cannot evaluate Christianity if you don't listen to what it says. I spend most of my life listening to other views. So just listen before you make up your mind. The central claim of Christianity is that Jesus Christ is God encoded in humanity. That is very big stuff, I realize it, but just come along with this. One of the central facts of Christianity is he died on a cross. That raises a very big question. What's God doing on a cross? Well, the first reaction I have is it shows that God has not remained distant from human suffering but has become part of it. Now, if that were all, we'd never have heard about it. But the reason we've heard about it is that he rose from the dead, literally, historically, the third day, and that changes everything. And the early Christians went out to the world and they said, you know, ladies and gentlemen, there is going to be a final judgment. And the judge has been appointed by being raised from the dead, and it's going to be a human, Jesus Christ. That was a magnificent message to people who had no hope of justice. You see, it's very interesting. When I mention the problem of evil, people want God to dive in and solve it. But not in their case. Not in their case. Now let's face this. This is big scale stuff. I know it is. But it's very important because it deals with another problem. And it's this. I suppose as students, you set up all night saying, well, if there's a good God and an all-powerful God, there couldn't be evil because a good God would, should, might, could, and all that kind of stuff. Do you remember those arguments? Did ever you resolve it satisfactorily? No. I've never met anybody, including myself, that ever got anywhere. And mathematics teaches you, if you don't get anywhere with one question, you'd better change the question. Here's my question for you to leave you with now tonight. Our problem is we face a mixed picture. I call it beauty and barbed wire. Look at the sky tonight over Arizona, the beauty of Orion. And if you have a telescope, you'll see the nebula in there. And bombs and barbed wire as you watch on television the atrocities of ISIS. We see a mixed picture. And we've got to face that. No theory that doesn't acknowledge that will get anywhere. So my question is this. Is there any evidence anywhere in the universe that there's a God that you could trust with it? I believe there is. And I believe that Jesus Christ has proved to be that God incarnate. And I've seen relief brought to so many people as they begin to let that sink in on their minds and hearts. And ladies and gentlemen, that's the main reason I'm a Christian. Christianity doesn't compete with other religions here because there's no religion offers me free forgiveness on the basis of that cross, which doesn't simply show that God suffers with us. It shows that Christ has suffered in a specific way to deal with our alienation and rebellion against God. And so open up the possibility of getting to know God. Wouldn't it be wonderful if some of you came up to this university and in the middle of your course, you discover it's possible in this life to get to know God and enjoy his friendship as I have done for over 60 years. Thank you very much.
For more information about the Veritas Forum, including additional recordings and a calendar of upcoming events, please visit our website at veritas.org.